that predicts the outcome for cognitive inputs. There are some questions like, why would we want an agent to learn? And if the design of the agent can be improved, why wouldn't the designer just program in that improvement to be limited? So there are three main reasons. So first, the designer cannot anticipate all possible situations that the agent might find itself in. And for example, a robot designed to navigate mazes must learn the layout of each new maze it encounters. And second, the designer cannot anticipate all changes over time. A program designed to predict tomorrow's stock market prices must learn to adapt when condition changes from boom to bust. And last third, sometimes human programmers have no idea how to program a solution themselves. So for example, most humans are good at recognizing the faces of family members, but even the best programmers are unable to program a computer to accomplish their task except by using learning algorithms. And we look at various learning systems used in practice, like linear models, non-linear models, and non-parametric models and support vector machines. So here we in this session we know about forms of learning, different types of forms of learning. So any component of an agent can be improved by learning from data, and improvement and the technique used to make them depends on four major factors. First, which component is to be improved, and what previous knowledge the agent already has. Third, what representation is used for the data and the component. And fourth, what feedback is available to learn from. So let's start with first, components to be learned. So as we know about several agent designs, the components of three agents include, these agents includes first, a direct mapping from condition on the current state to the action. And second, a mean to infer relevant properties of the world from the perceived sequence. And third, information about the way the world evolves and about the results of possible actions the agent can take. Fourth, utility information indicating the desirability of world states. Fifth, action value information indicating the desirability of actions. And sixth, goals that describe classes of states whose achievements maximize the agent's utility. And each of these components can be learned. And consider here an example, an agent training to become a taxi driver. Every time the instructor shouts brake, the agent might learn a condition action rule for when to brake, and the agent also learn every time the instructor does not shout. By seeing many camera images that is told contains buses, it can learn to recognize them. And by trying actions and observing the results, for example braking hard on a weight road, it can learn the effect of its actions. And then when it receives no tip from passengers who have been thoroughly shaken up during the trip, it can learn a useful component of its overall utility function. So that is component to be learned. Then representation and previous knowledge. So here we combine both, and we have already seen several examples of representation for agent components, like propositional and first order logical sentences for the component in a logical agent, and Bayesian methods for the inferential components of a decision theoretic agent, and so on. So effective learning algorithms have been devised for all of these representations. And input that forms a factor representation means a vector of attribute values, and output that can be either a continuous numerical value or a discrete value. And there is another way to look at the various types of learning. So we say the learning a possible incorrect general function or rule from specific input-output pair is called inductive learning, and analytical learning or deductive learning, going from a known general rule to a new rule. pattern in the input, even though no explicit feedback is supplied. The most common unsupervised learning task is clustering and detecting potentially useful clusters of input examples. And for example, a taxi agent might gradually develop a set of good traffic days and bad traffic days without even being even labeled example of each by a teacher. And then the next is reinforcement learning. The agent learns from a series of reinforcement and rewards or punishments. For example, the lack of a tip at the end of the journey gives the taxi agent an indication that it did something wrong. And the 2 points for a win at the end of a chase game tells that the agent did something right. And it is up to the agent to decide which of the actions prior to the reinforcement were most responsible for it. Okay. Then there is another supervised learning. The agent observes some example input-output pairs and learns a function that maps from input to output. And in component like a component one, the inputs are percepts and the output are provided by a teacher who says break or turn left. And in component second, the inputs are camera images. The output again comes from a teacher who says that's a bus. And in component three, the theory of braking is a function from states and braking actions to stopping distance in feet. And in this case, the output value is available directly from the agent's percept, and the environment is the teacher. So there is a next one of the next learning is this type of distinctions are not always so in semi-supervised learning. We are given a few labeled examples and must make what we can of a large collections of unlabeled examples. And even the labels themselves may not be the order or a clear proof that we hope for. And imagine that you are trying to build a system to guess a person's age from a photo, and you gather some labeled examples by snapping pictures of people and asking their age, and that's supervised learning. But in reality, some of the people lied about their age, and it is not just that there is a random noise in the data, rather the inaccuracies are systematic, and to uncover them it is an unsupervised learning problem involving images, self-reported ages, and true ages, and thus both noise and lack of the